People are strange.
People get ready.
People. People who need people.
Amen, amen, amen. That, of course, is The Impressions. You heard them at the beginning as part of my opening intro with People Get Ready. They are, of course, Hall of Fame inductees. They are Chattanooga natives, Fred Cash and Sam Gooden. They are Chattanooga residents. They were so kind to come into the paper recently and spend almost an hour, more than an hour, especially in Sam's case. The state of Tennessee is honoring them with a monument plaque, not 100% sure, still being decided, still in the works, but they are definitely going to be honored, and the marker is going to be somewhere in downtown Chattanooga. Fred reached out, and they're obviously proud of the honor, and they were willing to come and sit down and talk to me. Folks, I have to tell you, when I first thought of the idea for People with Barry, I had several people in mind. The idea was to do a podcast interview, sit down with some of the folks that I have done either stories on or just met or heard about or had an idea of something to do. The kind of stories that maybe require a little bit more in-depth discussion than a newspaper article, or maybe they splinter off into different areas that we, you know, can't necessarily get to in a print story. And they're also just things, to be honest, that I wanted to do. And right up there at the top had to be Fred Cash and Sam Gooden. I've known them both for well over two decades now. I consider it one of the greatest honors of my career and life to be able to call them friends and to be able to just to sit and speak with them. It's incredible. 60 years they've been doing this, had been doing this. They are now retired. About the time that I started writing about them, their career took a pretty incredible turn, in my opinion. They were always busy, always working, but they probably worked more in the last two decades than they did, except for probably the, you know, late 50s and 60s when they were churning out hit after hit after hit. Sam got there a little bit early for the interview, so he and I began talking, and we'll get to that here in a minute, because he moved to Chicago from here before Fred. Fred was still underage, and his mother wouldn't let him go. But Sam and Richard and Arthur Brooks went up early. They met Jerry Butler. Things started happening for them. Sam went up there to play baseball. And while he was working out with his semi-pro baseball team up there, the others were writing songs like For Your Precious Love. That's the one that kicked them off, and they talk about that. They talk about the name change from the Roosters to the Impressions. It was literally a luck of the draw, how that came to be, just as how they signed with VJ Records had as much to do with a winter snowstorm as it did their own incredible talent, which got them the gig. They talked about becoming a voice for social change. They were an absolute pioneer in that area. Talk about how people like James Brown would advise them that they were risking their careers by singing about such things and not just, you know, turning out pop hits. They managed to do both. They talk about retirement. They talk about Jermaine Purifori, who just so happened to have been our guest on Music Wednesdays at the paper that very day, that very afternoon. So I got all three impressions at one time. They talk about how
the whole key to their longevity and maintaining relevance
was based on knowing what made them successful. The formula, the vocals, the song structure. It was an interesting conversation to hear them talk about how they could bring in somebody like Jermaine to be their lead singer to replace Curtis Mayfield or Jerry Butler and still be the Impressions. That was very interesting. So, as I said, you're going to hear Sam got there a little bit early. We start talking about Curtis Mayfield almost right away. And then Fred will join us a little bit, probably 10 minutes in, if I remember right. And then we pick it up from there. So let's get into it. Here they are. Here's my interview first with Sam Gooden, and then both he and Fred Cash from there on out. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope you enjoy this as much as I did.
Curtis by.
And Curtis, Curtis was about, I think he was about 15. And Jerry was trying to talk him into joining the group that we had because we didn't really have a name. We called ourselves the Roosters, which, you think about all of the other acts that was out there. You had the Spaniards, you had the the guys, everybody had a name like that, and we couldn't get a name like that. So we just, I don't know why it came with Roosters,
right?
But we came up with that, and so Curtis came and he rehearsed with us for about a week, and his playing and I was singing, we started sounding pretty good. I guess we did that about 5 or 6 months. We just rehearsed.
Mostly doo-wop? And I'm asking because you the whole, with Curtis later, you guys became known for your social awareness song. So.
Yeah, but he was so young, Curtis was. When he started with us, he was about 15 years old. And he didn't want to leave the other group that he was with. And I think Jerry talked him into staying with us because he said the guys that you are singing with are kids. Saying if you join with us, these are men, right. You'd be a lot better. So we just went in and started rehearsing real hard.
And you were how old at this time?
I was over 20. I don't know exactly. That was 1950. That was the last of 1957.
And you were born when?
I was born September 2nd, 1934. But the guy across the street said they was getting ready to have, I guess you would call it, audition groups and thing at this high school. And he was a member of a group, and his group was going to be down there. And he said, y'all should come and sing.
Yeah.
So we decided, to go. But when during that time, when the guys' group don't like other groups outdoing them, so what they do, if there's a microphone, they say the microphone is broke, and you can't use it because it's all broke now. But It was fine when they was using it.
They also used to, groups were pretty notorious for doing the other group's songs, right?
Yeah.
They would go on first and then, so you couldn't do it? Or?
But see, we had no, we had no other song. We, I think, did lead on Sam Cooke. He did You Send Me, which is one of the big records during that time. And that's what we used to audition there.
But you guys, so you guys were doing original stuff, Jerry and Gary and writing.
Well, actually, we weren't doing none of them then. We just fooling around.
Right.
And so when it came time for us to sing, I said, but what they had it in the school gym, and if you sing in the gym, you got this echo that goes around. You really didn't need no microphone.
That's true, that's true.
So the voice would carry, it's almost like you was on a record. So we sung Sam Cooke, You Send Me.
Nice.
And so when we finished, we got a better applause than the rest of them. We were leaving, the bunch of us, and we were walking out talking, and this guy came up and said, y'all sound real good. Said, I'd like to be your manager. And I'm saying, manager of what? We haven't done anything. You know, we can't pay you no money. We just singing, you know. He said, well, what I would do is that let me manage you, and as things start to grow, then we'll talk about the other thing later. Hey, fine with us, because we wasn't doing anything anyway.
Right. Oh, that was 10% of nothing's.
Yeah, and that was Eddie Thomas, and he really liked the group. So, but he had this lady that he knew that had a connection with two recording places, which were down on Michigan Avenue, and he had with Chess Record and VJ Record. She said, that stopped, and I started doing what I was doing, and Jerry and I think Richard and Arthur was creating this song. They was, you know, they were writing it and rehearsing it, and the evening when I get through playing baseball, I'd come in and I would listen to what they were doing, and I just hum along with them, you know, when I felt like it.
Yeah.
But we're gonna take us to audition for a recording contract. This lady was going to take us down there to Chess Records. It was on a Saturday, and I think we had a big snowstorm had been around there, and man, there was snow everywhere. So here we go, here five guys with a guitar and a little hand speaker that you can amplify, and we go down on Michigan Avenue to Chess Record, and she's knocking on the door, and there's a guy sitting there just like you sitting right there, and he's sitting there looking at us. Never moved, never came to the door, never did anything.
Wow.
And I think it got on her nerve, and she's, we standing there wondering what the heck is going on. And she said, never mind, let's go across the street. Well, across the street was a black recording company, which was a VJ Record.
Yeah.
So we walk across over there, and there was, you go right in, there was a storeroom where they ship out all of the packets, records and stuff. So we go through there, and the guy, the A&R man, was in there. His name was his sister owned the radio station, but we talked to him when we went in there, and she said, "We're trying to get them on a record contract," and he said, "Okay, let me hear what you got." So We sung everything but one song. And he said, "You sound good." I said, "But that, is that the all, that's all y'all have?" And I told him, I said, "Well, we have one more song, but it, you know, that wasn't really finished."
Right.
He said, "Well, sing that one for me." And that's when we were singing For Your Precious Love.
Oh, wow.
And we started to sing it, and this guy jumped up, and his eyes got about that big. So here are these kids standing there, and they're saying, "Well, what is he getting ready to run us out of here?
What'd you do wrong?"
Yeah. But he said, stop. Hold on. Just stay right there. Don't move. And he went up the stairs. And he went up there and he talked to the guy up there. And then he asked the guy to come down. And here these two guys come down. And here we standing there looking crazy. You know, what is happening? And when he got down there, he said, "Sing that song again."
Wow.
And we started and we sung it again. He said, "That's it right there." So that's the song. And we signed the contract.
Sounds like and, out of a movie, doesn't it?
Yeah. And
who wrote the song? Who sang lead? That was the song? Was it?
Well, I sung lead on most of the stuff when we was doing all the other stuff. But when they was rehearsing it, when they was writing it, Jerry was singing the lead. And there was no need for to change anything because, hey, I don't know the song.
Yeah.
But the two brothers would think they wanted me to sing it. But I don't know the song that well. And Jerry knew it. He's so comfortable with it. And he let him sing it, yeah. You know. And it sounds so good when we were singing it for the audition. So the next week we went in and we recorded it. And when we finished, the only thing that we didn't have was a good name. So Eddie Thomas said, "What would we do? Everybody pick out a name and we put it in his hat. And we just shake it up and turn it around. Then the name you pull out of there, this is the way we're going to name the group." Well, Eddie had put in the name Impressions. And so I reached in and pulled it out and looked at it. Say, "Impressions, what the heck is that?" But he said, "That's the name. That's going to be the name."
So baseball at this point, were you...
Well,
getting paid? Was it just fun?
I was playing semi-pro ball.
Okay.
And a guy that scout for the Cubs, he had seen me at practice one day, and he asked me, "Did I want to be a professional ball player?" And I said, "Yeah, you know, of course you're going to say that to a kid." And he said, "This spring."
We were talking baseball and some of the early days.
I told you, you're talking to the right man.
Yeah. Yeah. So you're not even in the picture yet. So
I
we're about to get started
about
on
baseball.
That.
And
I love
a good ball player, though, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, but I don't watch it. Gooden, he's on top of it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's like what we did here when we was kids, is played ball.
You were... Yeah. Just to sort of wrap it up, but you were saying the Cubs guy had asked you if you wanted to try out. Was it because the singing thing started taking?
Yeah, you know, guys would come to a person, they would say, "Do you want a professional?" And of course, you're going to say yes. And he said, "Well, this spring, before we go to spring training, I'll come by and I'll take you down to spring training with the Cubs." Well, anybody can tell you that.
Yeah.
You know, I can tell you I'm going to take you to the moon. But I said, "That was fine." But after that, we recorded this record. And when they, the people said they did, he did come by, but I was gone. I was in New York with the group.
Okay. Fred, you couldn't leave because your mom wouldn't let you go, right?
Yes, I was a little bit too young, boy, and she wouldn't let me go.
What was it that kept you thinking you were going to go? I mean, it would have been easy for life to have gone this way while they were away. What was it that pulled you up?
I didn't have no thought about it. I thought it was all over with. I said, well, hey, these guys done made it.
That's what I mean.
Yeah, I didn't put no emphasis on it no more because I said, well, hey, they got the whole group together, you know. And so they came back through Chattanooga, and Jerry was getting ready to go on his own, so that opened up a spot for me. Okay. Yeah, but I didn't know that they had already auditioned a couple of other folks, and hey, I was just lucky to get in there, you know.
It's so interesting to me to look back and see these doors and windows that opened that seem so obvious, you know, and how else could it have gone? But when it's happening, you thought train had left the station, right?
That's right.
But you said you sat and look at Fred and I all but 6 months we've been together as a group.
Yeah.
That's right. It was just 6 months. It wasn't.
Yeah, Jerry stayed 6 months.
Yeah. Yeah.
So actually Fred was with this group for 59 and a half years.
That's right.
So
he's the new guy.
Yeah. And if somebody would say somebody would say, well, he's not original, what would you call an original?
Yeah.
You would call an original that's been there, that went through the hard ups and downs, the twists and the turns, and all of the hard work.
Yeah.
Those are the original.
That's funny. You're not an original, huh? Yeah. Only 59 and a half years.
Yeah. Only 59 and a half, yes.
I don't worry. Me, that I don't even worry about. That's it's just that I knew when Jerry was leaving, because we had talked about it before. It was a hard time for him. And when he was out there, that 6 months was like being in hell because these two guys just rode him to death. Every time the radio played, they never would say impressions. They would say Jerry Butler.
That's what the labels were doing, wasn't it, at the time? Splitting up groups, going getting the lead singer.
That's what VJ Record did.
Yeah, it's cheaper for them that way.
Well, they did just about all of the groups except a few that they like Calvin Carter sung with the Spaniards, so he didn't try to break them up. That was one reason.
Yeah.
And he couldn't break the Dales up because they came out of high school together. But if there was any, like D. Clark, he started with a group.
Yeah.
He was a lead singer. As soon as they put the record out, they pulled him out. They always think like two and one. You know, well, you got a lead singer here, and then you got a group here. Now you got two groups.
Right, yeah. You know. Did similar with Curtis later, right?
What happened there? I think about even VJ Records, you know. They didn't think we would make it.
No.
With Curtis doing lead, they just didn't think Curtis could sell records, you know? They didn't think it, you know? And they just didn't know. We had the writer with us, you know? And when Curtis started writing all them bums, it was all over with.
Yeah.
Well, the guy said.
Yeah.
He told us when we left VJ Record, they'll never make another hit record.
Yeah.
Told Sam Cooke.
They didn't think we'd never make a hit record, you know?
Well, see, and I told Fred later that I could tell him the reason why Calvin didn't want Curtis doing the lead on no song, because the guy that sung lead for the Spaniards sound exactly like Curtis.
Oh, yeah, had that type of voice, yeah.
And he didn't want no anybody else have that same sound.
Right.
And that's where we was going. It was headed that way.
Fred, before you got here, we were talking about retirement and the fact that you guys were able to choose when you retired.
Right.
And I didn't get into it. I wanted to wait for Fred. You guys were every bit as busy, weren't you, the last 12, 15 years as you were? Yeah. Certainly in the 80s.
Man.
Sure.
Probably even early on, right?
Too busy sometimes, you know.
We worked as much as we wanted to work, Barry, you know. And it didn't slow down. Mm. I mean, even now, I get calls.
I
said one your way the other day. You got that right. Doing the book or the movie or
yeah, it's somebody. Listen, Barry, somebody's calling all the time about doing the date, and I tell them we have retired. What?
yeah.
I said, hey, yeah, we've been off the road ever since 17, but we went back out in 18. You know.
But see, the only thing that I think about. The guy out in San Francisco had talked to him about us doing something before y'all retire. Make sure y'all make one last trip out here, and we didn't. We went to Japan.
Yeah.
And when we finished and came back, we were through.
Yeah.
And never did go out there.
That guy couldn't pay us the kind of money that he was paying us in Japan.
See, that's the whole
thing. That's why we come out of retirement. Yeah.
How was Japan? Because Jermaine, as a matter of fact, coincidentally, was our guest today.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no.
For the Wednesday show that we do every week.
And great singer.
Unbelievable.
I'm going to tell you something. I Fred and I both say, we wish that we'd have had him a little bit earlier, even during some of the time that we had Reggie with us, that we could have had him.
Yeah.
He has that type of voice.
He
do anything, can he?
He's a fantastic singer.
And a nice
good
guy.
Person.
Yeah, he's a good super
person.
Nice guy.
Yeah.
He says the same about both of you guys.
He got upset because he said, now, I went through all this rehearsal, went to all of these things, and I finally get comfortable doing all of y'all stuff, and y'all quit.
Yeah.
I said, yeah, you're right.
Well,
yeah.
See, some people don't know when it's time to quit, Barry. I know when it's time to hang it up.
In your head, right?
That's right. That's right.
So, let's go back, because the three of us started really talking about the time this sort of, I don't know what you would call it, second career, fourth career, eighth. Y'all never really went away, but it just really picked up.
Right.
I don't want to put words, but it seemed like back then it was sort of, well, we're just going to keep doing this till they quit asking. Is that fair? I mean, it wasn't like you had to work 200 days a year or whatever you were doing.
No, it's just that the people called for us to do tours and different things like that. It's just that we stayed away from home a long time because we never stayed at home that much. We would go on a tour, and we would leave that tour and go someplace else, and we'll go home for maybe about 3 or 4 days, but we're on the road maybe for almost a month. We go overseas, we go to Germany, and we over there for a month and a half. And that's, you know, you're away from home, away from the kids. Kids are just growing.
I think that's a better way of saying it, is you kept performing, and they got busier and busier because people kept asking.
Yeah.
I don't remember it being that you guys were, you know, beating bushes and all that.
Yeah,
it was that the demand was there.
Yeah.
I should say it that way.
Well, thank God, all those hits that we had, Barry, you know, that's what kept us going.
Man.
Those was good, solid records.
That,
the Keep On Pushing, the We Are Winners, the I'm So Proud. All of those songs was good, solid records.
Right.
Even when we added other people to the group, you know, it still kept right on. It slowed a little bit, but it kept right on moving.
And then it
Yeah.
Well, what Fred and I did, we tried to keep our sound. And what a lot of people didn't realize, because I know some of them would say that, well, Curtis not with them, they're not going to sound the same. But see, what they forgot is that Curtis was just one voice.
Right.
And he didn't make the sound. The other guys, the one that surrounded him with the voices, that made the whole sound.
Yeah.
So that when we put somebody in there that's very similar to what Curtis sounded like,
it was close.
Around him,
we don't still have that sound.
You know, the sound
and
was
we
there.
We kept that sound. Yeah. You know,
close but not identical.
There
which
you
I
go.
Think is important because I've seen bands that have had to replace the singer, and if they don't get it just right.
Yeah.
But keep trying, it misses something.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's true.
That's because they go off for a deep end. They get a guy that's singing lead, and he starts the way you want him to start. And then once he gets settled in there, okay, now I'll kind of branch out.
They want to do something else.
Do my thing.
But you have to bring them back. Hey,
see,
no.
You put it right here.
This is what it's supposed to be, you know, and that's the way you got to sing this song,
you know.
Jermaine said something to me today that I found very interesting, and you had said it before, but it didn't really resonate. He said, you guys told him, you're the lead singer. Mm-hmm. We're the backup. When you get out there, it's your show.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm saying that right. Mm-hmm. I know the first part. I don't know if you told him it was his show, but...
Yeah.
What's that like? I mean, that's for 60 years. It's kind of hard to give somebody the keys to the car, I would...
Well... He's we want to get him to sell songs. And the way you talk people into selling things is that they have a free range. We will be there to back you up on anything you want to do, or how we're going to do it, as long as we are doing it the way a group does it.
Yeah, you have to keep it in the confines of that song, you know. You can't let them get too far away from that,
you know?
And a lot of them, that's what they want. I want to sing it this
way. Yeah, I want to sing it another way.
You can't sing it that way.
Because the people out there, they're listening to that, and they sing this song with you.
Yeah.
You know? And with him...
That's the thing.
With him, we would tell them that if you're going to add something, add it to the beginning or at the end. Of the song, sing the song. Then, if you got some other stuff you want to add to the back of the song, go right ahead and do it. And we just wait on you to finish. And then, when you come down to the ending, and we end it with you.
I think that's one thing that really kept us relevant, Barry. You know, for the simple reason when them people come to hear the impressions, they're gonna hear that sound.
Yeah.
They're going to hear that sound, the good harmony, the good singing. And although Curtis is not there, they still going to hear that sound, that impression sound.
Same key.
Yeah.
That's the whole thing. Fred and I have been very blessed to be able to sing these songs in the same key that we recorded them in.
Yeah.
And that's, you don't hear that too often.
Mitch Ryder lives here in town now. I don't know if you got remember Mitch from the Detroit Wheels.
Yeah, I know of him. Yeah,
he lives not far from here, and we've talked. And I know he goes to Europe quite a bit and does these tours. And so it sort of opened my eyes. There's a pretty big market.
It is
overseas for classic rock, pop, whatever you want to call
even
it.
Even now, we probably could go. All overseas and we could probably go there for another 3 or 4 years, but 14 hours on a plane.
Yeah,
man.
I know, I get that.
Well, they enjoy what you do, you know. If you're doing it right, Barry, they enjoy. Them folks we played in London, they had us crying.
Whew.
They applauded and whistled and did everything off of one song for so long. I said, good Lord, we do another song, they do the same thing.
That's what Mitch has said that has stuck with me is, I guess in my head, I thought he has to go over there and do the hits, you know, verbatim. But he's just what you said. He said, no, if you go over and give them a performance,
there you go.
They absolutely appreciate there it no matter go. What you're doing.
Yeah, and don't really, I mean, if you sound like what you're supposed to sound like, they're going to really love
yeah.
you.
Yeah. I'm going to tell you that.
They really love
you. To tell you the truth, we sung in front of a lot of people, but when we did that show in London at that church, the great big church, old, been there for a long time.
Elton John, it was a play that.
It was it was the best audience I ever sung in my life. That when you sit up there and you sing one song, then you have to wait maybe
till they stop applauding.
Yeah, before you start another
Ooh,
song.
Yeah.
So that extended your show to maybe just a little over 2 hours. That's what you were doing, and then you go off stage, and you're sitting in the dressing room.
They're hooping and
they're still doing the same thing.
Hooping and hollering. Awesome,
man. It makes you stand there and cry.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. That was...
London was big, Japan was big, and those are too near the end.
Well, see, the thing is...
that's true.
Japan, they was trying to get us to go over there years ago, but...
We didn't have a promoter to send us over there.
Remember, they said they were saying groups shouldn't go to the Far East. You know, shouldn't go there because of how they kidnapped a lot of people and stuff. Said it's best that the singers don't go. So we said, hey, we will not go. But then, plus other little reason, and then until they came, Fred came, called me and said, we're going to go over there. You know, and I forgot that this is a Far East, and looking where you sit, here is China right here, and here is North Korea over here, and this other thing sitting down in here. You know, so man, but greatest people in the world.
They treat you so nice, don't
man.
They?
Going back to the fan things, I think I remember I got a call one day from a guy in Ireland, who wanted to know if I had any. Way to get to you, and I said, "Yeah, here's his number."
Yeah,
he called me back crying. He said he answered the phone.
Yeah, man, I don't know.
Fred Cash answered the phone.
Yeah, once I retired, man, can't nobody answer that phone because I know what it was. Yeah. Somebody wants you to do this or do that, and I tell them I'm retired now, you know, and I want to enjoy this retirement. What time I got left on this earth, I want to enjoy.
Like the other day, a teacher from Toronto, Canada, called me, and he retired now. He said, been talking with me on the phone, me and Fred, sitting around talking with us, said it made his whole career. Mm. And he wanted to call me and thank me for that.
Well, I don't know if I've told you both, but one of the best moments of my whole career was when y'all sang Happy Birthday to me over at Channel 12.
Yeah, I remember that.
You know, I thought, okay, they're singing. And then I got in the car and I thought, wow, that doesn't happen to everybody. So, but bringing it back, one of the happiest that I've seen you two was in that room over there, maybe the last time we spoke together when you had just got back from the White House.
Oh, yeah. Man. Now, that was the experience.
That was the coolest guy I ever met in my
life. That's what you said that day. That is a cool cat.
But he's smart, Barry. That guy is so smart, man.
God.
It'll scare you how smart he is.
When a guy got... That's when they had that flood in Florida, and all this stuff was going on. And he had just come out of a press room. We sat in the press room, and he come into the room with us, and it was as though he just met us. He said, "Oh, y'all must be fans of the Penguin too." And I thought, "No, man, we're from Chicago." He said, "I was just kidding." And we kidded. He kidded like that with us for the whole thing. And one thing he said to us, he said, "We really care about you all." That was a man that touched me real deep because that meant He wasn't talking about it just himself. He's talking about the people of this
right.
this country.
Right. But you know, we supposed to went out and campaign with him for about 2-3 days. You know, and we couldn't do it because we was in Atlanta in the recording studio. Oh, I hated that so bad. But that was already set. I got that email now at the house.
Yeah, that guy is bad. I mean, he was just so smooth, and when he said. Then they was proud of us, man. It just, hey, touch me, boy.
What was your expectation going up? I mean, I think I'm not trying to put words in your mouth.
Oh, to meet him?
To meet him. I think I remember you were surprised at how he knew you and came right over you, right? Yeah. And just very genuinely.
The way he acted is almost like, well, like me and you talking.
Yeah. Well, what had happened, our manager, Perry, called and said, hey, you know, the president is getting ready to get out of here, you know. And we got word that if y'all want to meet him, you're going to have to get on the plane and come to Washington right away. The next couple of days, me and Gooden was on that plane. Yeah. We went into Washington and met him, you know. And our song, Keep On Pushing, was number 2 on his playlist, you know. And that just did my heart good.
Well, talk about that. Yeah, I mean, because we haven't really talked about, and we did last time you guys were in here, but whole sort of shift in your music to the social conscious awareness thing that I think Curtis sort of took you into, right? What to tie it to the White House visit, what's that like to have sung those types of songs and then hear... many, many years later, have that opportunity. And then, sadly, if we're going to go full circle, we're right back.
Well, Barry, those songs afford us that opportunity.
Yeah.
Those kind of songs, that's what put us in a good spot to go to the White House to meet the president because of what he believed in. And as far as his whole situation, you know, those songs really meant something. Mm-hmm. You know?
Well, you had other friends of yours, the artists out there, James and some of the other people that they was coming to us saying that, man, that's gonna kind of slow your record up. People might not wanna see you all, book you all because of those songs you're singing.
So you're saying guys like James Brown and some of the others were coming and saying
they wouldn't.
You guys are making career mistakes.
Yeah, they would not. They would not touch them type of song.
Wow.
Well, he and did later.
After we did those songs, all of a sudden here they come.
Oh yeah, him, Marvin Gaye.
Yeah.
Everybody jumped on that bandwagon.
Gladys Knight and the Pips.
We was the first.
Yeah.
What was that conversation like? Not just with fellow musicians, but your label people had to have.
Listen, we had the best label in the world.
It was.
They let us do whatever we to do.
There you go.
They did not say anything.
Yeah. When we went in the studio. Nothing.
Why?
Why? We were selling records.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
He was selling them, but like James had to be thinking you're going to kill the goose here.
Yeah. Well, hey, the record company didn't say one word.
And I said a thing.
Not one
word. As long as he kept selling.
That's right. We were selling records. I mean, a lot of records.
Putting stuff out. And we put them out that way so much that we had our own people that go around and promote our records. He was hired to do this. And the other guy was hired to produce us. Nobody came in the studio with us but just us and Johnny Faye.
Four or five of us, yeah.
That's it.
The manager.
That's it.
The arranger and us.
That is so rare.
Nobody from the company.
That is.
Nobody come from the company. Because they usually have somebody sitting over here.
That's right.
You know, listen to what you're singing. No. They sit there and wait on us to send them the record.
That music. Now, that's what was amazing. They let us go in there and do whatever we want.
I don't hear too many stories like that.
Yeah.
It's wild. Because what we were doing now... Some of the songs that we were singing, we didn't put the original words in there.
So you edited yourselves even?
No. Curtis, he had to change the words.
Yeah.
But that was, now we knew because we sat down and sung it the way he wrote it. And there were the really deep words that were said in there. We would have got We a Winner would probably, somebody probably threw that stuff in the garbage right there.
Like in one passage, Curtis had the black boy done dried his eyes.
There'll be no more Uncle Tom.
Yeah.
At last, his blessed day has come, and we a Winner.
See, they wouldn't put them lyrics in there. They changed.
No.
Are you talking about like on the sleeves?
No,
they made you change the word on the singer.
On the record.
Yeah, on the record.
Those are the words that was with the song.
Yeah, I mean it was deep.
When Johnny Pate would say, "Hey, we can't sing though. We can't put those words in there." So yeah. Curtis sit right there, wrote different words around it.
Yeah,
very deep words. But it meant the same thing.
That's right. That's
now, was this later? I mean, because you're saying as long as you were selling, they weren't messing with you. But when
they didn't mess with us, period.
No time did they mess with us.
Who's making you change the lyrics is what I'm getting.
The arranger, Johnny Pate.
He said, I want you to sell this record.
Yeah.
And I wanted to make sure that it gets played.
That was my next sort of question, was if any of the four or five of you ever said, wait a minute, this one, I got to eat.
Well, we knew it. We knew it, too. Yeah.
Gotcha.
We knew we could put those words on there. We knew that. And we laughed about it a lot.
Yeah, I can see that. We did that here, too.
That's right.
Even when we went out to do shows, "This Is My Country," there's some heavy words in there.
Yeah.
But those were left in there. Why? Because we felt that they made a point in the song.
Did you have to change for different parts of the country?
Lyrics in there? No.
For shows?
No, everything straight same. No. We went and did those shows. No. We didn't change nothing.
No.
That's what it was.
No, it's just, I'm going to tell you, we had a white audience access to sing these songs. Because maybe Fred might write down a show where we might leave that song out. He said, okay, we're going to this college, we won't put that song in there. But they asked for that
song.
Somebody
requested, yeah.
You guys, I would assume, earned that reputation. Right?
Yeah.
An audience that came to see you knew what they were coming to see is what I'm getting at.
There you go. Okay. Yeah. But see, we didn't know that.
No.
You know? So
it's
that's
pretty
why
brave of you.
It was. I'm going to tell you something.
We back up in the hills.
That's right.
Where nobody was. Yeah. I mean, we
nobody there but us and these kids.
Yeah.
We done shows at a great big, these college kids have a show at one of these old great big buildings back up in the woods.
Nobody
back there but just us and our
this
band.
This skin here and your color, that's all.
That's it.
And hey man, everything went off.
But see, what we wouldn't do, if one of the ladies asked for autograph, we would not sign them unless they brought their fella with them.
That's a great point. And that's, it never occurred to me till you just said that, but in addition to you guys being pretty headstrong about who you are and the sound that you have, you've always been gentlemen that I could see.
Well, that's the only way. That's the only way to be.
Well, that's how we were brought up, Barry. You know, my mother and father was in church every Sunday. I was too.
Hey. You know? Same thing.
And hey, we were just brought up that way. And as time went on, Curtis, his parents was in church as well. His grandmother was a preacher, so
it
all played out.
We go on stage as professional as we could be. And we look totally different on stage. Then we come off stage, show is over. Now we can act the way we used to act.
It's Sam and Fred from Brainerd.
Yeah.
Grandpa and...
Yeah. Time to have fun.
Yeah.
Or somebody said, "Boy, you don't act the same."
Well, I was always an introvert. Barry. You know, I didn't go out a lot. After them shows, I go to the hotel.
I wouldn't go.
That was the run of that. I would go back to the hotel, man, and just enjoy. And like I said, maybe 2, 3 o'clock in the morning, you hear Curtis knock on the door. Yeah. Hey, Fred, come over here and listen to this.
Yeah.
And he'd be writing some songs, sitting on side the bed with his robe and his guitar. Right. Take a listen to this. I sit there and listen and say, hey, man, we got another hit.
Wow.
We got another hit.
One of my favorite stories that you guys is the Eric Clapton.
Oh, Eric.
Experience.
The best, I'm going to tell you, the nicest person you ever want to meet. You ain't going to find a nicer guy than Eric Clapton. This cat, I mean, he took care of us while we were there. Anything what we wanted, we were there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you remember the year?
91.
Yeah.
I was going to say 2010.
Yeah.
I take it all back. We've known each other a lot longer.
Yeah.
Because I was writing about that.
Wow. Yep, 9-1.
But what I remember is you guys, he invited you in, you went to the studio that evening just to say hi, hello, and then...
Do one song,
and you were to show back up the next morning or afternoon or whatever and record, but...
Well, he asked us, did we want to, you know, record an album with him, but we went to do just one song, which was I've Been Trying. And it went so well in the studio, he said, hey, y'all want to do an album with me?
Yeah.
I said, yeah.
But it's that went so well part. You went back to your hotels and learned the parts, right?
Well, one song we learned right there in the studio.
Okay.
The background.
You're talking about his songs.
Whatever. Well, I just remember you telling me that you had gone over you were going to go the next day and learn everything, but you guys went to the hotel and learned it. Prepared.
Oh, well, we were ahead of him.
That was Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Okay.
This is what he closed his show with.
Yeah.
And he had no background to it. And he said... while y'all are here, do you think y'all could find a background for this song?
Okay.
So he gave us a track with him singing and the music and everything, and we took it back to the hotel.
Okay.
After rehearsal. And of course, when we get back to the hotel, we would take maybe an hour or two to sleep. And by 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, we'll go to maybe Fred's room or somebody's room, and we get in there and we start rehearsing.
Yeah, he was surprised that we learned.
Because we had it the next day.
That's what I remember the story.
Yeah.
And we came to the studio. He said, "Did y'all come up with any kind of thing?" We said, "Yeah." We sung that background behind that song, and this cat jumped straight up. He's, oh man, that is beautiful.
That's pretty cool.
It was.
That's what we're, Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
So, why Chattanooga? You both came back. You hang out like friends, I assume, right? I mean.
Well, this is home.
Yeah.
Well, we don't hang out. We've been together so much, Barry.
You know all the stories are.
Man. So hey, you know, but we call each other, check on each other, and see how everybody's doing.
Well, I guess that's what I mean.
Yeah,
but we don't go to no clubs and stuff around here.
I didn't imagine that about you two anyway. But
because I've saw people in the store, grocery store, and they said, "Wow, I didn't know you guys were in town," and I won't say anything. I won't say, "Well, I live here," you know. And they said, "Man, that's really something. How long y'all gonna be here?" You just start laughing, But they never see you, because we already don't hang out.
Right.
We don't go to this place or that place. Clubbing, I've done enough. I've done enough clubbing, and we've been to all these places. All that do is get you in trouble.
Well, you just want to enjoy the family now, you know. We was gone so long from the family, you know. So, hey, you just want to be a part of that.
And we got a babysitter there, you see.
Yeah,
and
busy.
I love every minute.
Got a job.
I love every minute. Yeah, I love it. I love it.
The reason we're here together is this state honor. Right?
Yeah. Well, which is great. I think they just honored, she said they honored Taylor Swift. And we was on that list, and she said somebody else that they honored as well, you know. But I told her, this is just wonderful. And I don't know what made me answer that phone. Because I hadn't been answering the phone, you know.
You didn't answer when I called a couple of times. I wasn't going to bring it up.
Yeah, I'm sorry, but I just, you know, after I come off the road, I say, ain't nothing important no more, you know. And we not going to do nothing else. But when that lady called, I just had to pick up the phone, hello. And it was her. She was telling me about what she wanted to do, you know, what was in store for us, a marker. And this is going to be beautiful that they're honoring us, you know.
And it'd be something that people could see. But you're trying to put it where people can see it.
Can see it, yeah.
Like his grandkids. And my grandkid can go by and they can see this.
Right.
But we want to put it where the most people are going to see it.
Absolutely.
You know, because this is a tribute really to Sam and I.
Yeah, know? Absolutely.
So,
It's something that we can see. It's not where they put something up when we are gone, you know.
That has to be kind of nice to.
Yeah.
Be alive while it's happening.
You can look at it, you know.
That's true.
Because I know somebody was saying, well, why they got buildings, why don't they put the name on a building? I said, if they do that, you have to be gone. They're not gonna put your name on no building if you're still here.
Yeah, that's right. It just now feels like a lot of people are starting to appreciate the level of talent that has come out of
the city. Yeah.
You know, for the longest time it was almost surprise.
Yeah.
That somebody would do well from here. But
yeah,
like I said, Mitch Ryder, you guys, Richard Lloyd lives here. There's all kinds of the Nashville, more and more creative people are moving here and appreciating the city. And then when you say, well, yeah, you know, Sam and Fred lived here forever.
Yeah.
Always been
that's
here,
right.
You know,
yeah.
from
that's
here.
Right. Yeah, that's
so it's,
right.
It's a source of pride for us as well as you guys, I would think and hope.
It is, you know, but hey, I love it here. I do, man. Since I moved back here, I love it. I wouldn't want to go anyplace else to live right here.
That's why I guess I was asking, you could have lived anywhere.
Yeah.
Certainly
yeah.
In the entertainment business, it's different now because of the internet and all, but 70s and 80s, you pretty much had to live.
There's some place you want to be. You want to feel comfortable.
Well,
you just relax and be comfortable. And this is comfortable. I go home, they don't know where I'm at all. You know, only time they see me is when I have to go and do something.
Yeah.
But otherwise, they don't know. They say, well, I don't know where you live. I don't know where you go. I wouldn't do this or anything. It's just, you know, when we call them and ask them, would they do that? And they say, yeah, well, I'll do that. I'll meet you certain place, you know, and that's fine.
Yeah.
But I enjoy it. Chattanooga's beautiful. It's a beautiful place.
And I told Fred, and I said, hey, before long, this is going to be the most beautiful city in the South, right here. Now, it's a name now.
Right.
It's not a little town that they sit between Nashville and Atlanta.
You go through it on the way somewhere else.
Now, all of a sudden, Chattanooga's been talked about all over the world now.
Well, we sure promoted it.
I cannot thank you both for giving me so much time.
Well, Barry, we appreciate your time as well, you know, and